Ok, so, hello everybody. So I hope the sound is working well. Yeah, it's okay. So today is the first session of the second semester on this topic. How can I move? Oh, wait. Wait a minute. Okay. So the first session, the second semester on Burnside type result for fusion category. So we are covering this paper. So the first session of this semester will be a review of the last semester. So if you did not attended the last semester, no problem. But I will quickly review. So the review will be as follow. So I will go through the slide of last semester, and I will quickly read what I wrote, except the proof. And it should take 1 or 2 weeks to cover the last semester like that. So here it is the QR code for people who are not yet in the WeChat group. So this video will be available online in two ways. One way will be on the website of BIMSA, and the other way will be on YouTube. So perhaps some people are listening this course later on YouTube, for example. So you can scan this QR code if you want to have the news about this class. Okay. So let's start. Okay. So Burnside type result for fusion category. So we will introduce this topic. We introduce this topic with a character theory of finite group. So here I put three character table of finite group you can find online on this website. So it's very easy, and if you look carefully this character table, what you can observe. So each row with a degree different from one, they always have a zero. You see, here the row is different from one, and you have a zero here. Everywhere. Zero, zero, zero. And also here. And so, in fact, Burnside proved that this is true for all finite groups. And he proved that, so any irreducible non-linear character. So non-linear, linear character mean of dimension one. Because the character, yeah, the degree is one. But then the trace of the irreducible is exactly the reducible itself. That's why we call that a linear character. Otherwise, yeah. So if it is non-linear, so if the degree is not one, we prove that there always exists. Vanishing element for this character, which in other words means there exists an element in the row which is zero. Okay. 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 And so here I just remarked that here we consider the row, but you can also consider the column. And in fact, there exists a dual version of that, If you consider the colon, which is more recent, which is due to Isaac, Navarro, and Wolf. So, yeah. Anyway, sorry, that's the point here. Okay, so what about that? So, this result of Burnside was extended to all weakly integral fusion categories. So it was done in the modular case by these people, Galacki, Naidu, Nikšić, in 2009. And subsequently, it was done by Sébastien Bourtiou last year, in general, without assuming modular. So if you take so any weakly integral fusion category, you consider if you consider the character table, which can be defined exactly as for the group, then you have the same result regarding the row and the zero, etc. So the goal of this course is to extend this result to a large class of fusion ring. So here it was proved for fusion weakly integral fusion category, but in fact we will provide an extension for fusion for some class of fusion ring and more generally for hypergroup. And we will get so generalization for a class of fusion, a class of hypergroup, and also we will talk about the dual version I mentioned before. Because when you have a fusion ring, the dual of a fusion ring is not a fusion ring, but it's always an hypergroup. And so the notion of hypergroup is, as I will explain, is stable by taking the dual. Taking the dual is equivalent to transpose the character table. You have your fusion rule, you have fusion rule, you can make character table, but from character table, you can make fusion rule. If you transpose, you can get some rules, but there are no more fusion in general, but there are still hypergroup. Okay. Okay. And so we will use this extension. We will show that for some fusion ring, it's not true. For a class, we will show it's true, but for some class, we will show it's not true. And so it will provide a categorification criteria in the sense of a necessary condition for categorification. If a fusion ring do not satisfy this property, then it cannot be categorified. So this is what we are interested in, categorization criteria. Okay, so I already explained a little bit, but here I should explain more. What is the motivation to introduce hypergroup? The question is, okay, here we have application to category theory. So the question is, can we have the same application without going through hypergroup? Because hypergroup is a bit more general than fusion ring. And people in category theory are not very familiar with the notion of hypergroup. And they may question whether it's really required to go through hypergroups. As I already explained, the dual of a fusion ring is not a fusion ring. The dual of a fusion ring is hypergroup. And so, in this Burnside property, we will define the notion of dual Burnside property. And in fact, it will mean that the dual is Burnside. So, we will need to deal with hypergroup. So this is one motivation. Okay. And the hypergroup is stable by duality. Okay. So yeah. So this is what I already said. You have a Burnside and dual Burnside property. So yeah, I wrote that. It's not clear whether we can really avoid the notion of the use of hypergroup Naturally. Okay. So we will. So here it's a warning. No? What I explain in this first paragraph, if there are some notions you don't know, everything will be explained in detail. So in particular, we will start now for the notion of hyperloop. So you consider a finite dimensional algebra over the complex field. You consider a finite basis B, and you assume that the unit is in the an element of the basis, so it's a unit all-star algebra, and you write so the product of two elements in the basis can be decomposed as elements in the basis with some coefficient. And these coefficients here are complex numbers. So here there is a big difference between with fusion ring. In fusion ring, here they are integer. So it's much more general. And so in fact, this algebra is just the algebra generated by B. Okay. So what is a hypergroup? So we need some assumption to get an hypergroup. It's not enough to get to have a basis. So you have this kind of algebra, this kind of basis, and this is called a hypergroup. So first you need an involution on the basis, satisfying such that in fact so this number, as we said, it's a complex number in general, but when you consider the coefficient here, you take A star, and here you take the unit. This coefficient should be positive. So it is a strong assumption. Again, in the fusion ring, this coefficient should be one. So it's more general. Otherwise, it's zero. The element of the basis of a hypergroup will be called standard element. So this is the standard notation. In a fusion ring, we call that a basic element. So maybe sometime I will say standard element or basic element, or doesn't matter. So as I said, for fusion ring, the restriction is more restricted. So for fusion ring, it is integer, non-negative integer, and here it's one. So the difference with hypergroup and fusion ring is that. Okay, so a fusion ring or hypergroup is not just an algebra, or not just a ring, or not just a basis, but sometime we will simplify the notation and we will just write B, and we will call that the hypergroup. Or we will just say IH and we call that the hypergroup. But it means the algebra and the basis. Okay, so here some notion about hypergroup. So hypergroup is called symmetric if you can commit A and B here when it is for the sum of one only. Otherwise, it will be called abelian. In general, if you have C, it's here. It's called normalized if this sum is one. So you sum over all the possible coefficient here, and it's one. Okay, it's real if all the coefficients are real, rational if they are rational, not real or negative if they are real or negative, etc. And abelian, of course, if AB equal BA, etc. For all elements of the basis. So, because we will very often consider abelian real negative hypergroup, so abelian real or negative, we will use this abbreviation for real or negative or abelian real or negative. And yeah, For your information, real non-equivalent hypergroup is a literature sometimes are called table algebra. Ok. So let H be a normalized hypergroup. So normalized is there. The sum is one here. You consider linear map from H to C, which map to any element of the basis is mapped to one. And so we state that this is an algebra morphism. So the details of the proof is here. I will not read, as I said. This is a review part of the last semester, so I try to go as quickly as possible, and so I don't read the proof. You can go to the video of last semester if you want to know the details. Okay. This map will be used several times in the course, and it has a name, it's called the augmentation map. So it's an algebra morphism. Okay. Okay, so the involution on the basis induce a star algebra structure on the algebra. So it's a finite dimensional star algebra, so it's semi-simple. So it decomposes as a direction of finite dimensional algebra, matrix algebra. Okay. And so here you can observe that in fact, if you have n i, the sum of the n i square is the dimension of the algebra. Okay. So you consider each block. So you have this algebra and you have this block like that for the matrix algebra. So each block corresponds to a central primitive idempotent, which will be denoted Fi for each MNIC like that. So central mean it's an idempotent. The central primitive idempotent. Okay, so I don't want to go into the details. It just, in fact, you just need to know that in fact this Fi is the identity on this block and zero everywhere. In fact, it's equivalent to say it's a central primitive idempotent. Okay, so H is normalized. Okay, and so here we consider this augmentation map. You put one everywhere, and in fact, we can prove that if the hypergroup is normalized, then it decomposes like that. So the kernel of the augmentation map, so the augmentation map split. It split, and so you have the it decompose the hypergroup like that. Okay, but this is one dimensional, so I have no time to go into the details, so you should check by yourself why it is one dimensional. The image is one-dimensional, so the quotient with the kernel should be one-dimensional, something like that. I don't remember. So it must be one block here. It's one irreducible block. And we call this block I equals zero. Okay. And so this the prim central primitive idempotent corresponding to this block will be denoted F0. And in fact, so mu 0 is an element of the dual of that is an element of H star, the linear map. And in fact, we will see that for every there will be a standard basis for the dual, and we will have a central primitive idempotent for every element of the dual. the basis of the dual. So we will see that later. For now, we just need to consider F0, so which is in some sense trivial component. OK. So this class, there is an issue about notation in the sense that we will, in fact, we are using the notation from the literature, but sometimes in the literature you see that, sometimes in the literature you see that or like that. And in fact, there will be a slide later which is completely dedicated to the notation in the literature and in this paper. So there may be an issue about notation because sometimes we use that, sometimes that, or sometimes. And there is a notion, I guess, if I remember, there is a notion which has five different notations in the literature. So it may be confusing. So that's why I wrote a table where we summarize all the notation. Okay. So very important notion. The hypergroup is called H integral if this quotient is an integer. So remember that the axiom of hypergroup is saying that this is positive. In particular, you can make a quotient, but there is no more assumption. So if the quotient, if the inverse is an integer, then the hypergroup will be called H integral, and of course, this will be an important assumption. We will use this kind of assumption to prove the Bernstein property. Okay, so if we want to simplify a bit the notation, here we have the basis element. We can write it like that, only the index I, j, k. And this, when you consider the with the dual and the sum of one, coefficient of one, this will be denoted h I. Okay, anyway. So again, a notation we have to memorize. It's a bit okay. Okay. So if you consider a fusion ring now, and you consider the dual, and by dual, I mean you consider you take the fusion ring, you make the character table, so the character table of the fusion ring. So you have a fusion ring, you have a basis, and you have a fusion coefficient, fusion matrix. You have fusion matrices coming from the left multiplication of the basic element. So you have several fusion matrix. And these fusion matrices, at least if you assume, maybe we need to assume commutative here, otherwise, it may require some. So the explanation I will give is only for the commutative case. Otherwise, it's a bit more complicated. So in the commutative case, all the matrix fusion matrix are simultaneously diagonalizable, and so the eigen value of the simultaneous diagonalization. So you write this fusion matrix, you diagonalize simultaneously diagonalize, and you pick each part is diagonal like that, and you put them in a table. This is the character table of the fusion ring. You put this table. Now you transpose this table, and you have a trans. And you make a new fusion coefficient. Remember, as I said, from a character table you can get a fusion ring, but this you can go the other way around. From if you have a character table, you can consider some inner product on the column of the row, and you can make some coefficient. So you have fusion ring character table, okay, but if you transpose the character table, you get a dual, and this dual is a hypergroup, and if it is H integral in this sense, no, not if. So here it's stated that this is if the fusion ring is weakly integral, then the dual is always H integral. But the convert is false. So fusion ring whose dual is H integral is always weakly integral. So the converse will be okay. No, no. A fusion ring whose dual is H integral is always weakly integral. But if so, this implies this. So I said the converse. But this do not imply this in general. This is not true. And in fact, it may be involved in the categorization criterion. If you have a weakly integral which is not H integral, it will be used for a categorization criterion. So the converse is false, but it's true for Grothendieck ring. So Grothendieck ring is fusion ring, which can be categorified. So it is a categorization criterion. You take a fusion ring, you compute the character table, you compute the transpose, and you get back. And if you don't have this property, then and if you started from a weakly integral, then it cannot be categorified. So this is good. So it's a categorization criterion, as I said, dual H integral. Okay. So here we are in the section one. So it is the introduction part of the course and of the paper at the same time. So this is the first main result of the course and of the paper. So you take a commutative fusion ring with H integral dual, as I explained before. And you take a standard element, which a Frobenius per dimension is different from one. Then there is an element in the dual, in the basis of the dual hypergroup, which vanish on A. So it's exactly saying you take the fusion ring. You make the character table, it is saying that there is an A. So it means you can find. Wait, so there is mu. Yeah, for all A, so you take an A, which is not one. So it may be one one, and it's not one, and there is an element in the row which is non-zero. So there is a notion of character pole for general fusion ring, as I showed before for group. And so the statement is exactly as I said for group, the Bernstein theorem. So it's true for any fusion ring if, for any commutative fusion ring, if the dual is H integral. So this is the first theorem. So in particular, if it is not true, then the dual is not H integral. Then it cannot be categorified. So it's another way to it's easier it's easiest it's an easier categorization criterion, easier to check because you just need to compute the character table, and then you look at the row or the column. You don't need to compute the few coefficient of the dual. Okay. So the element. The basis of the dual hypergroup are called character, and they are ring homomorphism from H to C. Okay. Algebra homomorphism. So here there is a confusion in the literature. The character of wait, algebra homomorphism. So when you say a character of a group is a trace of an irreducible representation. But so it's not necessarily an algebra homomorphism, but here we assume it's commutative. So an irreducible representation here is one-dimensional, so it's a it's also an algebra homomorphism. There is a confusion with that. Sometimes character is algebra homomorphism. Sometimes character is just a linear map. You have to be careful about that. So, so. Ok. So we will prove a more general. Oh, what we will prove? We will prove something more general than fusion ring. We will prove something with hypergroup. More specifically, certain class of abelian rational normalizable hypergroup, which will be a generalization of that, and which will make sense is not just a generation for generalization, because we will need that. For example, we will apply that for the theory of modular tensor category, modular fusion category. Okay, so now, okay. So an element of the basis of a hypergroup is called group-like if this ratio is one. So in particular, is a unit. So it means that this product, the product of the element of A with this dual, has one component, and one component with one, and the coefficient of this component is that. In other words, you can reformulate it like that. The product of that, the coefficient of the component is zero if C is different from one, otherwise it's like that. So it means that it has, in other words, it means that it has only one component with a unit. So it's called a group-like. Okay, and so the set of group-like elements of a hypergroup form a group, the final group. For the multiplication of this group is a multiplication of the hypergroup, and this group is denoted like that. Okay, so the hypergroup will be called to have the Burnside proper vanishing property, or in the rest we will say just it is Burnside if we have this character table property here, which can be stated like that. For all elements of the basis, there is some element in the dual basis, on the basis of the dual or hypergroup, vanishing on A. So that no, there are two possibilities. This A is group-like or not that. Exactly as we said before, for final group, if it is non-linear, then you have this zero element in the row. So for any element in the group, for any element in the basis, it is group-like or you have a zero element in its row. Okay. So this is Burnside property. So in fact, the theorem before state that a commutative fusion ring with H integral dual is Burnside. Because yeah. Okay, so now okay, so here is an example. So you take a commutative fusion ring of this form. So it's a character ring of a finite group. Then the Frobenius per dimension of what is A? So yeah, when this property, which is here, as we said before, character the Frobenius per dimension is one, is equivalent to so what is A here? So maybe it's a dictionary, but A linear character is a one dimensional. Okay. So maybe there is a confusion, maybe it should be like that. Anyway, so the Frobenius power dimension is one if and only the degree in the sense of group is one, so it's a linear character, etc. I already explained that. Okay, and here what I am saying is that so for all elements of a group, you take the order of this element and you apply. So if rho is one dimensional, then it's a linear character, so it's an algebra morphism. So in particular, the you can move the order from inside to outside, and though you have it's a root of unity. So the element of a row of a linear character is always a root of unity. Okay. Okay. Does that matter? Ah, yeah, it may matter a bit. So, yeah, in fact, when you consider a group, character ring of a group, what is called the element of the basis of the dual corresponds to conjugacy class of the group. Okay, so there are, in fact, the representation of a character ring of a group is given by a conjugacy class. Okay. So here, which is important to mention, example of fusion ring which are not Bernstein. So we do not satisfy the Bernstein property we explained before. In fact, there exist simple integral fusion ring which are not Bernstein, and we found very few. Okay, so in particular, they cannot be categorified. So here I put the example. So among all the simple integral fusion ring we classified, and we classified the thousand of fusion ring, we found only four. So it's very few. It's very rare for a fusion ring to be non-Bernstein for an integral fusion ring. Here is one example. In fact, rank 9, deep dimension 2520. And this type and the fusion data. So we found four. You put the fusion data here. Okay. So if you compute the character table of that, you will find a row with a row for that, which is without zero. But the row correspond to, in fact, the product of the row are the determinants. So it means that among this matrix, one of it has determinant non-zero. It is exactly the same thing. Okay, so okay. Now, what about that? Yes, this is exactly what I said. In this case, you can say the determinant is non-zero. You can reformulate the Bernstein property involving the determinant non-zero for a matrix, yeah, so the Frobenius power dimension is the norm of the matrix, the L2 norm. And so it means that the so Bernstein property means that for any basic element whose fusion matrix has norm one, so the fusion matrix has norm one, if only the determinant is non-zero. And it's not true in this case. For example, I guess this one has determinant zero and norm six. Yeah, see what I wrote here. So, Ok. Now. Ok. So here I state that it's easy to see that the hypergroup is Burnside if and only the set of invertible standard elements coincide to the set of group-like elements. Ok, so it's exactly what I see. It's more or less determinant non-zero mean invertible. And group-like element mean norm one. So this is reformulation of that in the hypergroup framework. Ok. So. Now. Section 1.1. So we will. So the dual hypergroup of a normalized hypergroup. Okay. So you take an abelian normalized hypergroup like that. Okay. So by the abelian assumption, the basis of the dual form. So the dual basis is the basis of the dual. Because it's abelian, so the every solar orientation of that are all one dimensional. Okay. Okay. And so we can define the multiplication on the dual as follow. So we define the multiplication on first on the dual basis. So you take two algebra, yeah, mean algebra morphism. You take two algebra morphism from the basis, and you compute. So you determine the multiplication as so you define the multiplication component wise. So define it as defining all its value for any element of the basis B. And it will completely define this linear map. So for any element of the basis A, in fact, this is just the product of mu IA, mu GA, like that. And then we extend by linearity, we get something defined on all element of H, and so we really get an element here, and this is a way we get the multiplication on the dual. Okay, so I guess it's a good moment to make the pause. So it will be the pause now on six. Like that. So the pause. Okay. So we defined the multiplication on the dual basis, component wise, like that. Okay. So we get a algebra structure on the dual. And so we get a few coefficients on the dual like that. So we are defining the dual hypergroup here. So you have a basis. You have a basis. You have a hypergroup. You have a dual basis, and you have a multiplication which generalizes to the whole dual. So you have an algebra structure on the dual. Is decomposed into the element of the basis, and in fact, like that. Okay. Okay. Now, so here, strange notation again for the. We can also call like that if you prefer the fusion coefficient of the dual, but In the literature, sometimes it's called like that. Anyway, in this paper by Sébastien Bourtiot, so for any abelian normalized hypergroup, this pair is also an abelian normalized hypergroup. And so the involution here on this, what is the involution here? In fact, it is given again component wise. You define the involution on the dual element, on the basic element. You just say component wise like that by involving the dual of in the initial hypergroup. Anyway, so in the rest of the class, we will denote the dual hypergroup. We'll use this notation for the dual hypergroup like that. In fact, in the case of abelian normalized hypergroup, because it's in this case we know it is well defined, it forms an abelian normalized hypergroup. So here, show as for normalized hypergroup, you putting the dual here, it's the same thing as taking the complex conjugate. So if you remember the coefficient, the HI we defined before, which was 1 over NI star 1, something like that, for the usual hypergroup. You have the same for the dual with this weird notation. And this will be called the order of this element of the dual hypergroup. So this will be called the order. It's just a notation. So for any real non-negative hypergroup, we will define the adjoint as a sub-hypergroup. So we will define that in more details later. So the adjoint. So you consider this element like that. So you are summing over the element of the basis. You take the dual, you make the quotient. You consider this element. And you consider all the component, the decomposition of this element. And what it generates is the adjoint. Again, this notation makes sense in category theory because it is the dual of the forgetful functor. It's the induction. You have a category and you have Stringfellow center, and you have an induction, which is the dual of the forgetful functor, from that to that. Induction functor. And it looks like that. So the adjoint are the sub-hypergroup generated by the component of that. Next. So you take a real non-negative hypergroup. You consider the character Frobenius per n dimension. So here I recall that the Frobenius per n theorem can be defined for real non-negative hypergroup because of real non-negative. In fact, the Frobenius current theory is a theorem about a matrix with a non-negative entry. So it works for fusion ring, but in fact, fusion ring, these matrix are non-integer, but it can be just non-negative real. It works as well. So you have the notion of Frobenius current dimension for hypergroup, and it is a character. So it's a, in this case, it is an algebra morphism denoted like that. And in fact, it may be the same notation as we said before. We already introduced. So this primitive central idempotent of that is the F0 we already mentioned before. And here, another notation for that is called the integral of the hypergroup. Okay. So now, you so wait a minute. So, okay, so now if you take like fusion category, and you take the Grothendieck ring, this element in this case is called the regular element. Okay, so okay. So hypergroup is called normalizable. So we already defined what is a normalized hypergroup. If we have, remember, we have the sum of NABC is equal to 1. But normalizable mean you can transform it into, so you start from something which is not normalized, but you can make the good rescaling to make something normalized. And in fact, there is, we will see a lemma which will say that it is normalizable if and only if there exists an element dual in the dual basis which do not vanish on all elements of the basis. So this is equivalent to be normalizable because in fact you will normalize by that. And so we need this to be non-zero. Okay. And so, because the normalization depends on the choice of a character, in fact, a normalizable hypergroup will be denoted as a triple algebra basis and this character, linear, this algebra map. Okay. But of course, it's not true in general. You can have hypergroups which are not normalizable. So in particular, you can have hypergroup for which this is not true. Okay. Now, okay. So here is the notion of dualizable. So notion. Yeah, we define a notion for hypergroup. In the literature, you can call that normal dualizable probability group. So in a Harrison book, for example. But here is the framework of hypergroup. An abelian real non-negative hypergroup is called dualizable if its dual is also abelian real non-negative. So again, it is not true in general. So let me here show remark coming from my own previous research. So in a paper with Liu Changwei, myself, and Jin Songwu, published in Advance, and a subsequent paper with Juan in IMRM. So We proposed a notion of sure property here, which is reformulated as three positivity or primary three criterion of a for a fusion. Oui. In fact, a commutative fusion ring is three positive in the sense of these papers, mean that it is dualizable as an abelian real negative. So it is dualizable. So this notion of dualizable is very important. So you have an abelian real non-negative hypergroup. You consider the dual, and if the dual is also you also have this positivity, real non-negative, so it's like if you say positive, so you have this positivity notion on the dual, and this positivity notion on the dual is exactly the three positivity. Why three? Because when you want to compute the coefficient n I j I a b c, you need three entry. When you consider the dual, you need three characters, and so this three positivity, in fact, is exactly saying that in the dual, they are all positive, non-negative. So maybe we should say three non-negative, but it's why it was denoted like that. In fact, this is the whole notation three positive, which I often use, but in the paper it said primary three criterion. Yeah, I like three positive, but should be careful. Anyway, so the three positivity. So this notion of dualizable for a commutative hypergroup reformulate as follow, which work also in the non-commutative case. In fact, you take the fusion matrix, the Kronecker product three times, and you divide by the Frobenius power dimension, which is the L2 norm of the matrix. And this sum is a matrix should be a positive definite matrix. Maybe like that. Don't need any strict. So there is two notions of positive matrix. One notion is said all the entries are positive, but it's not the notion we are taking here. It's positive definite. And this is usually when you write this notion, this symbol is for positive definite, not for positive in the sense of all the entries are positive. Okay. And so this is very easy to check by computer. And in fact, yeah. So it exactly corresponds to this notion, dualizable as abelian real negative hypergroup. So this is important. Okay. So here in this section 1.2 of the introduction, we will state all the main result of the course. Okay, so the order of a normalizable hypergroup generalizing the notion of global Frobenius power dimension of a fusion ring is just like that. So for fusion ring, here it's always one, and here is the Frobenius power dimension of the simple object square. But in general, you pick this character which is non-zero everywhere for the basis. And here it is, remember this notation hi is just inverse of the coefficient of one in I star, like that, which is one in fraction ring again. Okay, so this is a good way to generalize the notion of global Frobenius power dimension, or if you prefer, to generalize the notion of order of a group. That's why it's called order here, because people are dealing with the general notion of group, so it's order of hypergroup, like that. Okay, so we will characterize dual Burnside dualizable abelian real negative hypergroup as follow. So you start from an abelian normalizable hypergroup. Okay. You assume its dual is real non-negative. In fact, I put the abelian in parentheses because it is abelian, the dual is automatically abelian. So we don't need to assume it to be abelian, but it is. The following are equivalent. This hypergroup is Bernstein. Or the following identity hold this identity. So this Bernstein property about vanishing on the row of the character table is equivalent to this kind of equality, identity. And this is very, you will see, maybe today, maybe tomorrow, in what sense this is very important, because we can use that to deduce some arithmetical property of the hypergroup of the fusion ring or of the fusion category. In fact, in the integral case, you can deduce some divisibility property, etc. There are some. In fact, my co-author Sébastien Boursiou published two other papers after this one, and he was able to prove a lot of nice new arithmetical property. In fact, we will see some of the arithmetical property here, but he proved a lot of, yeah. So this is the way you can, this is very important. So the product, we will see soon why. So the product of all the character square is equal to, so decompose as like that. So you have this, this coefficient. So this is a, I already defined that this is a Nii star 1 dual to the maybe inverse, I don't remember. So the Hi but in the dual, this Hi but in the dual. Anyway, you have this kind of coefficient. You have to normalize like that. What is important here, you take the, you sum of, here you sum over all the elements of the basis. Here you sum only on the dual basis. So wait. Here they are all elements of the dual basis. So it's like if you have new j in b hat. Here we just the dual basis of the adjoint sub hypergroup. And this is the order of the adjoint. Anyway. So this kind of formula will be very useful for arithmetical property, as we will see. Okay, so be careful sometime. Up to now, I wrote all the index starting from zero, but I prefer to write all the index starting from one. So what I call mu zero will be mu one and x zero, x one. So now all the index start from one. So your unit is with index one in particular. Okay, so you start from your fusion category. You consider the Grothendieck ring. Use the set of a simple object up to isomorphism is finite like that, not like that. Okay. The Frobenius power dimension of the of this simple object is noted, will be noted di. The index set like that, okay. The element, the basic element in the Grothendieck ring is a class up to isomorphism, so it's a class of object, it is not in xi. Okay. Okay, so the statement of theorem 1.7, which is here, okay, require dual real non-negative. So we need dual Rn, which is where it is written. Such that the dual is Rn. Okay. Okay. So you can say, okay. So the point is that, okay, this, okay, you prove that, but for something with this kind of assumption. And maybe you can say, maybe this assumption is too strong, or it's not general enough for it. How large is this class? And in fact, this class is very large. Any weakly integral premodular category is a dual real negative. In fact, rational. So any, in particular, if you have braided spherical fusion category, weakly integral, the dual is real negative. Okay. And as I said in the paper, two of my papers, any unitary fusion category has a real negative dual also, which is what we call three positivity. So this statement is it's true for any quotient ring of any unitary fusion category. And most of the fusion category we know are unitary. Of course, there are some contour examples. So we know contour example of Grothendieck ring, which are not unitary, cannot be categorized as a unitary category. In fact, they cannot be categorified as a pseudo-unitary, which is even weaker. So unitary implies pseudo-unitary. And in fact, Andrew Chaupiret found example of Grothendieck ring, which are not pseudo-unitary, admitting no pseudo-unitary categorification. Pseudo-unitary. So the notion of pseudo-unitary is defined for category, not for ring. For ring, you just have the Frobenius power dimension. So remember, pseudo-unitary means the categorical dimension equal the Frobenius power dimension. So for ring, you just have the Frobenius power dimension. So Chaupiret found an example where any category, so it can be example of fusion ring. It's not integral. It can be categorified, but it cannot be categorized as a fusion ring where the Frobenius power dimension equals the dimension, categorical dimension. So this is, it was not clear, it exists. It is quite recent, that this is a very nice example. It's not integral. But we check on this example, it's also three positive. So, yeah. This, In fact, it's open whether any fusion category over a complex field is free positive. It's not true. It's not known. What is not true is that for at the fusion ring level, it's not known, it's not true. You have plenty of counterexample. It's true for unitary, but is it true for any complex fusion category? We don't know. So this is what I said. Either a fusion category over C, which is not three positive. This is very interesting. In fact, here, so it can be a work. So we have a unitary proof here, and can we make a non-unitary proof and get, so it may be interesting. No. So there exist fusion rings which are not positive. That's why it's a criterion. Okay. Okay. So now we discuss about Burnside. We can state, as I said, hypergroup is stable by taking the dual. So if you have a statement for hypergroup, you can have the same say statement for the dual, and you can reformulate the statement on the dual for the initial hypergroup. This is exactly what we want to do here. So a normalizable hypergroup, so here now we put the one instead of zero, is called dual Bernstein if its dual is Bernstein. And there are plenty of examples coming from finite group theory. So recall that a commutative fusion ring is Bernstein if and only if for all if and only if a matrix, a fusion matrix is of norm 1, if and only if the determinant is non-zero. It's a way to reformulate the existence of zero in some row, etc., when the non-linear, because this is a Frobenius power dimension. And so this is one if and only if the character is linear, etc. And So this is not this is like that. And the character ring of a group, which is a commutative fusion ring, is always Burnside. This is a Burnside theorem. And as I said, it extends to any weakly integral fusion category, but it's false for integral fusion ring in general. So it's a category fusion criterion, as I said several times. Okay. Now, a commutative fusion ring whose dual is real and negative, in particular the tree positive case, is dual Burnside when so it's the same thing, the zero in the character table, but for column, not for row. So a column of its character table has an entry, zero entry, if and only if the norm of the column is strictly less than the Frobenius point dimension. The norm of the column is the notion of formal codegree. So this is very interesting, this dual version. It involves the notion of formal codegree, which is very important in fusion category theorem. And so you have the dual version when you consider column instead of row. And a final group will be called dual Burnside if its character ring is dual Burnside. It's not true in general. It's not true that all final groups are dual Burnside, but it's true that every nilpotent final group are dual Burnside. And this will be proved in this course because we will prove something much more general for hypergroup. Any nilpotent hypergroup are dual Burnside. So it will be extended to commutative nilpotent fusion ring with real and negative dual. Yeah, we always need this assumption. And also a hypergroup. Okay, so for nilpotent final group, it's always dual Burnside. So you have this property on the column with zero, etc., a formal codegree. What about non-nilpotent? So we found there are 144 final groups of order less than 32. Among them, 30 are non-nilpotent, and among them, only this one is not dual Burnside. So all the other ones are dual Burnside. So all the groups of order less than 32 are dual Burnside, except this one. So in particular, this is dual Burnside, this is dual Burnside, etc. So a final group without center is dual Burnside if and only if every column of its character table except the first one containing the degree has a zero entry. Why? Because in fact, centerless, in fact, reduce every column are of this form because in fact the fact that the formal codegree is equal to the order of the group is equivalent for the group to have an element in the center which is non-trivial. So the formal codegree in group theory it is called the order of. So I always forgot that. The order of the conjugacy class. So it is the order of the conjugacy class or is a ratio with the centralizer of an element. So let me think. Formal codegree, it should be the order of the centralizer of an element of the conjugacy class. Any column correspond to a conjugacy class. Any element, you take the centralizer, and the order of the centralizer is the same thing as the formal codegree for character ring of group. Okay. So in particular, if it's centralless, you only need to care about the first column, otherwise you always have a zero. The centralized is dual Burnside if, as I said,
like that. So it's not always true, but it is how you can reformulate the definition of dual Bernstein for centralless fusion finite group. And so we checked this property for. It's much easier to check for all the group of order less than 1,000. Centralless and dual Bernstein imply almost simple. And almost simple, remember that it means that it is a group which is in between a simple non-abelian finite simple group and its automorphism group. It's what is called almost simple group. Okay. But this requires this assumption because you can find counterexample of that. For example, this one. This is centralized dual Bernstein, but it's not almost simple. Okay. So here I put two questions. Is it the first example here? And is there an example which is not a product or a twist product of almost simple loop? Well, they are all of this form. Anyway. In particular, a non-abelian finite simple group is centralless because the center is a normal subgroup. And so simple means there is no non-trivial normal subgroup, so it must be centralless. And we checked that so we checked all the finite simple groups except the alternating, which are more complicated. So except for the alternative for which we checked in this range for between A5 and A19, there are dual Bernstein if and only if N is not in this subset. But it's an open problem in general. What is the characterization of the set for which this is dual Bernstein? Otherwise, for all the non-alternating finite simple group, all the non-alternating symmetric groups are dual Bernstein, except the mature group is two mature groups. So this is an interesting story for finite group theory. This property, Bernstein, so Bernstein is always true, dual Bernstein is not always true, but we can say something about the classification of finite simple groups. They are all the non-alternating are dual Bernstein except these two. So here we have all the infinite family of Lie type. You have all the sporadic except these two. So this is a huge. You have a huge, huge set of example. Infinite family of set of example. Okay. So now we are very, very motivated. From group theory, we can come back to a hypergroup. So we can reformulate the Bernstein theorem generalized to hypergroup to the dual hypergroup, and it is as follows. You start from a normalized abelian real abnormalized. I don't remember if we really need that anyway. Abelian real non-negative hypergroup and the following are equivalent. The hypergroup is dual Bernstein, so the dual is Bernstein, or you have this identity which is similar to the identity we get for the term 1,7. But here we make the product on the element of the basis of H. Before we make the product on the element of the basis of dual basis. So this is quite strange. The statement for the dual Bernstein involve the basis, but the statement for Bernstein involve the dual basis. And again, you have the adjoint subcategory, hypergroup, some coefficient, etc. So in fact, this is exactly the same thing because there is a natural, you can deal with hypergroup or is dual in the same way. So if you have a property for hypergroup, you have also a property for the dual, as long as you have the good assumption. And this is the assumption here.
Okay. And again, this has very good arithmetical property, as we will see. Okay. So, let me check the time. 6 minutes, yeah. So now, what if you reformulate that for fusion category? You take a fusion category, which is with a commutative Grothendieck ring. Then this Grothendieck ring is dual Bernstein if and only if you have this equality, which is exactly this equality, but with the notation of category, Frobenius per dimension instead of this order, the adjoint of the category, etc., etc. Okay. Here is a theorem saying that, okay, so an abelian real rational non-negative hypergroup, if it is dual Bernstein, then it is rational. So what? Abelian, normalized abelian rational real negative hypergroup if, wait, so maybe there is a typo here. Because we already assume rational. Okay, wait. No. Rational mean N, A, B, C are rational. But it does not mean that the Frobenius power dimension R is rational. You have plenty of fusion ring, which are non-integer dimension. So it generalizes what we said before. You have it forces some integrality here, rationality, the dual Bernstein property. And a very important corollary is that any commutative dual Bernstein fusion ring is weakly integral. So this is the corollary I mentioned before. Because here, for fusion ring, it must be an integer. Any commutative dual Bernstein fusion ring is weakly integral, but the converse is not true. Okay. Now. So there is a way to define a universal grading group for a fusion ring, and you can define similarly a universal grading group for abelian real negative hypergroup. This permits to define similarly the notion of nilpotent abelian real negative hypergroup and to prove that a dualizable abelian real negative hypergroup is nilpotent if and only if its dual is nilpotent. So the nilpotency is invariant by dual. And they are the same nilpotent class, okay. And so we deduce that a nilpotent dualizable abelian real negative hypergroup is both Bernstein and dual Bernstein. As we said for group, any nilpotent group, fine group is Bernstein, dual Bernstein, but this is true for abelian real negative dualizable nilpotent hypergroup. Okay. And this is very important. Modular fusion category. So you take a modular fusion category, then the Grothendieck ring of a modular fusion category is Bernstein if and only if it is dual Bernstein. But remember that we already know that in the integral case, it's always Bernstein or the other. So for integral modular fusion category, an integral modular fusion category is always Bernstein and dual Bernstein. So which is so we it will be very useful because we will be able to use this kind of equality to deduce some arithmetical property of the category. Okay. So the proof involves a Drinfeld's map. I will not go into the details of that. So Drinfeld map. So you have the Grothendieck, you have a category, and it's Drinfeld center. You have a forgetful functor compared to that. The right adjoint is called the induction functor. And if you compose F and I, you apply it to the unit, you get what is called an algebra. It has a structure of algebra object.
And in the modular case, there is a map from this home space involving this A and this home space involving this A, but in the other side. This map is defined involving the S matrix. Okay. So this, I just wanted to recall what is the Drinfeld map. This is proved, used to prove that, which is very important. And here, then I don't know if I will be able to. Yeah, the arithmetical property will start. We will see the arithmetical property tomorrow. We see the set of prime divisors, etc. So tomorrow, I am teasing for tomorrow. So let me just finish this page. And it will be enough for today. So this theorem, which one previous theorem here, imply this identity imply that for any modular fusion category, which is Bernstein, then we have you have this property. Okay. As I said, so it holds for always, it always holds for weakly integral modular fusion category because it's always Bernstein. Okay, so corollary, as un, okay, as for un, but with the group of invertible objects. Ah, okay. So you can. If the group of invertible objects here is odd, you don't need to put the square here. So you have the same equality without the square. And that's all for today. So we will. I need to put another color. Which color? Orange. Not much. Because I will have, I will put the slide of today will be up to there. So it's done for today. So very soon in the WeChat group there will be a link when you can download the PDF of the slide up to here, and the link to the video, and we will continue tomorrow. So see you tomorrow.